when I see like what's coming up in terms of like even like the way our computer are moving so fast, I'm like so excited.
So if you provide to people like water, they will be able to do something else in their lives. We need to have hope, we need to believe in a bright future, and we need to work toward that bright future. Don't give up, we need you. For all these women, just think about the next generation, just think about the legacy that you are going to leave behind.
Hello, my name is Kate and I am your host for today's episode, where we welcome Earth scientist Dr Fadji Maina, who works at NASA in Washington DC, to talk to us about the power of AI to tell us the future of hydrology and the power of education to transform a girl's life.
If you look at our Earth from space, like 70% of the surface of our Earth is covered by water. Our bodies today as human is like 60% of our bodies are made up with water. So water is essential for us. Water is like all around us, and water is part of our Earth, and our Earth is part of our space and the solar system. So that's how it's linked. Everything is kind of tied together. And we are trying to understand how water resources are going to respond to climate change. We live today in an era of climate change. We may know it, like we know that the Earth, there is a global warming. In some regions around the world, we already have started to see the impacts of the climate change. And we know that this is going to intensify in the future. So we are trying to understand how water is going to change to respond to climate change, and by like let's say 2090, are we going to have enough water to be able to live on Earth? That's kind of questions we are trying to answer, like just trying to see the big picture of what I'm doing. And to do it, I'm using basically satellites data, because if you think NASA is satellite, so NASA has a lot of satellites measuring everything on Earth. So I use this satellite together with mathematical model and high-performance computing to understand this kind of water cycle.
And Zinder, the town in Niger where you were born, is somewhere that's experienced severe water shortages. So is this something you always set out to solve?
Yeah, so like I grew up in Zinder. Actually, Zinder used to be the capital of Niger. And back in 1926, the people in Niger thought that because Zinder has a lot of water scarcity problems, they thought that Zinder cannot host a capital, because you know capital is like millions of people that are going to live, and we might need a lot of water to be able to sustain all these inhabitants. So they then decided to move the capital of Niger from Zinder to Niamey, which is like 1,000 kilometers away from Zinder, just because that's what they say, that it's like we have water problem. I was born in 1991. That was like 1926. And when I was born also, there are a lot of water problems. I grew up in a society when you just wake up, you just have to open your tap and you are not going to see any water because we do not have it. That's why it was like really interesting. As a young girl, I was asking to myself, what are we going to do today to be able, like, can we understand this problem? Why us? That's like simple questions I was asking to myself, like, why us? When we are watching TV, we can see people around the world, basically, some people have enough water. So when people do not have water, they need to take time to be able to find this water. And then girls, especially girls in Africa, you know, that the girl, they will be like walking around the day trying to find water. And they do not have time, for example, for education to be able to learn something. So for me, like trying to understand water issues is really like trying to solve so many problems at the same time. So if you provide to people like water, they will be able to do something else in their lives.
And it sounds like you were so fascinated by the science when you were in Niger that you left home at 16, am I right, to go to university, which is quite rare in Niger. And what was that experience like?
The point is, like, when I finished my high school, we didn't have university in Zinder. So it's either you leave the town, Zinder, to go to the capital, which is like 1,000 kilometers away, or like you just give up to your to your university degree. So yeah, for me, it was like, it was challenging, but at the same time, I think because I finished high school early at 16, I started to think that I'm somehow different from others, and then I can do whatever I want to do. That also what led me to kind of push boundaries, because I started at 16, you know, and then when you learn this at like a young age, then you kind of like organize your life, saying to yourself, you know, you are different to others, so you can go push boundary, do whatever you want. You don't need to follow, like say you have to do it this way. You just have to have like your own dreams and do whatever you want to make your dream reality.
So where were you at university and what did you study?
We have like scholarship for like top students of Niger to go abroad to study, again, because we do not have all the possibilities in Niger. So I got the scholarship to go to Morocco. And then when I was in Morocco, I did the 3 years bachelor. And then after that, I moved to France. It was also another scholarship from the government. In Morocco, I did earth sciences and solar system. And then in France, it was more about hydrology. And then for my PhD, I then applied to another scholarship. And then that's how I did my PhD. So kind of like all my studies, I got scholarship. I was lucky enough to get scholarship. My parents didn't pay like tuition fees for me.
And at NASA and at Berkeley, you have these supercomputers with huge amounts of data and you have these satellites. And how exactly do you use AI and machine learning to understand more about the future of climate change?
So basically, when you think about water, basically, water is something that is moving. You can think about something that you cannot even see at some point, it just disappear, because we are not able to like track it and to see it. It's not like a car that is like moving. We need to create models, mathematical models. So just like trying to describe how the water is going to move on Earth by using equation. So then when we have equation, we need to solve them. And that's why like high performance computing comes in, because we have a lot of equations to solve, and then we can simply do it on like our computer, because like just, it might take like hundreds or thousands of computers to be able to do it. So we use this high performance computing. And the satellites came in because we need to have data, basically, because these equations need to have like kind of input and parameter. And then we use the satellite to be able to have these parameters that our model needs to be able to track them.
It's no secret that some of those most negatively affected by climate change are women, and especially women in rural, remote areas. Mm-hmm. How do you think we ensure that they are at the forefront of international discussions?
I mean, now today we feel like in the United Nations, for sure, I know people, like a lot of people, start to understand this kind of problem, that it's really affecting women. And because, like, you know, sometimes people start from the like the top saying, yeah, we have like this kind of issues, girls' education and stuff. But then the more people try to understand like the issue about girls' education and other like diseases, a lot of diseases today are caused by water. These are like pollution or like water scarcity and stuff. So the more people start to get interested in about these issues, the more like they start to think about solution. And I think that, yeah, today I think I'm kind of quite optimistic, because like people start to understand this thing and start to get like the sense that it's very important. And I think that's something that also comes with climate change, because, you know, today like a lot of people know about climate change, because climate change also has started to affect the life of many people. So even like people in like developed countries, they know, like, you know, it's happening, we need to do something about it, and then we have to move to policy to make decision and stuff. So it's coming, I think.
At NASA, what do you see for the future of this technology, of the artificial intelligence usage? How do you see that developing as we move forward?
I think in the future, I'm very excited about the future, because sometimes when I feel like, when I see like what's coming up in terms of like, even like the way our computer are moving so fast, I'm like so excited, like, you know, in the 5 years maybe we'll be able to do it, something that we are solving like in one day today, in just like few hours. We really like gain time, and then you have more time to think about other problems. And also when you think about how we are developing our satellite, we're becoming smarter, like, yeah, we are really changing. Like the precision of our satellites going to change in the future. And because like also AI is like really improving, we'll be able to like analyze so many data at the same time. And this can only improve our understanding of our Earth and what's going on. So yeah, I think that, yeah, we should be optimistic about that. And then there is like kind of like silver lining about in this kind of climate crisis that will, I think that that will come with technology for sure. For me.
So AI is being used at such a high level, therefore, to make predictions about the future of climate change. How do you feel about the way in which those predictions are then treated by politicians and the wider public?
I think there is, should I just do like the parallel with what's happening around the world with the COVID-19 crisis? I think that we can see like how sometimes scientists are like strict about what should be done. And then by the time that it goes to like the government or like the policymaker, something has changed, and then the message has changed. And then we are like, what's going on and stuff. So yeah, I think that this crisis should also teach us something at some point to be like, yeah, scientists should be strict of what we are saying. So there is a lot of like people do not believe in climate change and climate science, but I think that as scientists we need to like keep pushing, keep like repeating ourselves and saying to people like, you know, we know what we are saying. And I think one thing to do it for me as scientists not to let only like journalists and like politician talk about science, because they don't really understand what's going on. As scientists, we should also be able to go to the public, to just speak directly to the public and to say, you know, that's what we think, that's what we found with our models, that's what we think about the future, and you should trust us, because this is like how we build the model, you know. It's just like kind of try to make people believe in what you are saying, which is very important, I think. So I think that for me, scientists should like really try. It doesn't have to be like at like big level, you know. Everyone can do whatever he wants at small scale. So it's like in your own community, in your own family, you can just speak, and you need to know how to speak also as scientists. I think it's very important, because usually people think that scientists are boring, they start speaking and then nobody understands what they are saying. So we need to do also the effort to make ourselves like clear, and just to speak clear, and to so that everybody can understand what we are saying, and do it at small scale, community level, family, your grandma and stuff, and then you can move forward and we can have an impact.
Well, Fadji, you are anything but boring. Therefore, when you talk about, you know, it needs to be understood on lots of different scales and in lots of different places, in that sense, we have to educate people all over the world. Are you hopeful for the future of the education of girls in Niger?
Yeah, I am. I'm very hopeful. As I mentioned, like, it's kind of our culture, you know, we live with hope and we should never give up hope. We need to stick to hope. So I think, yeah, if many things are changing today, if you think also about how technology has changed, for sure, like, we are still, like, behind in terms of technology of in Niger, but it's really coming, you know. Back in the days, I didn't have a chance to have my own computer when I was in Niger high school. It's like out of question. Like, I had got my first computer when I was in Morocco doing, like, that's the first time that I had to use a computer and stuff. But now today, 10-12 years later, like, many girls in Niger have access to like to computer science, and like also like because we have that technology that starts to like arise in Niger, more or less everywhere, we can be connected with these girls. Like, I know that I have some session with Nigerian girls in their high school. We are going to talk about education. So we have these kind of like tools that are coming. I think that's going to change things and the way we are educating our girls, and I think that girls today in Nigeria have have the opportunity to be connected with the girls from all over the world, you know, so we can really move forward with that. So I think technology is something that is really, it's really going to change things. And then also the narrative of girls has started to change in Nigeria, you know. When I got my job at NASA, I received a lot of congratulations from many people in Niger, and a lot of girls from Niger were sending me messages and emails saying that I want to be someone, and so I want to be like you. And it's really made me happy, because I'm so now they have something to believe and they know that it's possible. And there are a lot of other scientists from Niger or politicians, women from Niger that now today girls for initial can look at and say, I can do it, I can become like that woman, I can do it. And so we can change things. I think
it's such an example of how role models are so important in
exactly.
It's so important to be able to see yourself in other people. Do you have any role models?
I do have a lot of role models, and the way I'm seeing role models, actually for me, coming from Niger, I didn't have a chance to have a role model like scientist, like someone who is doing science, PhD and stuff. But I got to love people and to learn from everyone that's surrounding me. Even if you didn't go to university, you didn't go to high school, these women taught me something giving up, having hope, never give up. Tells me women are really struggling every single day to do their best and to improve the lives of their children. So that's something that I learned, and that's something I keep today. Also, I really look at everyone in the society, whatever you are doing, whatever you are in the society, you have something to teach me. So I really try to look at everyone, especially women, and really take the best of their qualities and feel I can really be like this. This is something that's I can do it. I can be a better person by just being as kind of that as that woman, or I can be the better person by having the help of that woman, or having the courage of that woman. So for me, it's a mix of everything. I don't have specific.
No, it's so wonderful to see that there's a quality to admire in every woman. I think that's an amazing message. And Fadji, listening to your story, it kind of feels as if you've got everything right. But what advice would you give to your younger self or to younger girls?
I would say to be bold, because I wasn't bold at all. That's also I was raised back home in Nigeria, you know. We are taught to be humble, to not be bold, to be shy, to not speak aloud or talk a lot, you know, to say that as a girl you should be shy, you shouldn't be I won't understand this. I think that's, as a scientist, I had to kind of unlearn this and try to push boundaries. That's something that I have to learn. And I think, I'm still kind of there is still my culture, because that's something that I'm raised with that. So sometimes I don't ask questions. I'm kind of I'm not going to change things, but yeah.
Which kind of leads me on to my next question, which is, what is it like being the only woman from Niger at NASA?
Being someone from Niger, usually throughout my career, many people are are you from Niger? First thing they would say, it's Nigeria. I would no, it's Niger. It's another country in Niger. And people will realize, I never heard about this country. That's what people say to me, because I have never met someone from Niger. And for me, it's people don't know where my country is. At the same time, they know me, and then they're so there is a country called Niger, which is different from Nigeria. Yes. And then you should show your base, because people are going to see the country through your eyes. And then whenever you are going to say, people are going to say, this is what people of Niger are. So it's just their mindset or whatever they have in their mind. You need to say to them you should do your best, show your best. So people, next time when they will meet someone from Niger, they'll be,
they might be good. So you know, we can change our own narrative by doing that, I think. And we need to change our narrative so that people will know us for something that is good.
And what has your personal experience been of leaving Niger and experiencing people's preconceived narratives?
Yeah, they have preconceived assumptions, and that's also what's about, you know, that's what social media is doing, that's what TV is doing. They are here to just make us feel like, yeah, we have these and these. So yeah, it could be like, yeah, it could be frustrating. And this is not something like work, because work, I feel like work people are kind of educated, but like that's something that like in daily life, when you try to move from one country to another, like even like finding apartments or like trying to rent something, you know, the way people are going to look at you, it's like, yeah, I don't know what's going on with her. I don't know if I should trust her. So that's something I learned, because when I was in Niger, you know, I didn't know like how people, like I was like living in Niger my own life. I'm like, okay, I might be a good person. But then when you leave the country, you go to the world, and then that's when you start to feel like, okay, so that's how people are seeing me. And then that's when you start to understand like this kind of preconceived assumption about you, and then try to fight them.
So what do you say, and what's your message to girls interested in STEM careers, and particularly women of color?
I would say, don't give up. We need you. For all these women, just think about the next generation, just think about the legacy that you are going to leave behind, and you are giving hope to many girls today, and many girls today around the world can see you and feel like, yeah, I can also do it, you know. So it's not about you, but it's about a generation.
And I know that you now take the time to meet many girls both in the US and in Niger to educate girls and to tell them your story. So what do you hope for the next generation for women in tech and in science?
So, you know, when we think about technology and sciences in general, it's just in our mind. When we think about a scientist or like an engineer, just see like a man like sitting down and just doing the science or like engineering. So we need to change that, because also, as I said, like if you think about the problem that we do have today, something like climate change and something like, how are you going to use the massive technology that we are creating today? Need to hang people from different backgrounds, from different countries, from like different, like women, both women and men, and everyone basically, because people might think differently, and we really need to think about the problem differently to be able to tackle it, you know. So that's why I kind of like spend my time, dedicate my time to go to talk to girls, to women, and like to push people toward education. And also like the passion analysis, because I am from Niger, and like the literacy rate in Niger is something like 30%. So it's not that high. And we have a lot of issue about education. And the moment, like as someone, a girl from Niger, I had this chance to be educated, to have education, to travel the world, to see like the power of education, and to see what education can do to a girl. I want every single girl today to be able to have that opportunity, because I can also compare to see like, okay, I know many girls, many people who just didn't have a chance to go to school or didn't have a chance to go to university. I know like how their life today look like. And I know that if they had the chance to have to be educated or to have like a degree, their life will be totally different. I can see the impact of education. That's why I really want everyone to be able to have education and to be able to do science.
Would you say that you're quite hopeful for the future?
I am. I'm quite hopeful. I mean, that's also what's something that I learned in my culture in Niger. We give up, you know, when you grow up in this kind of society, when people do not have all they want, like people are basically living with the little they have, they just like hold on like cup, you know. That's kind of like my culture. So I really want to like take that culture, that it's hope. We need to have hope. We need to believe in a bright future, and we need to work toward that bright future. And I think today, even if like, you know, we have climate change, we know that we are going to have a lot of like cyclones or like hurricanes and stuff. We know that these things are going to happen in the future, but we do have science today. And the way we are doing science today, it's like now today we have high performance computing. We can do like this kind of computation that we never thought that we would be able to do it back in the days. But today we have all these abilities. So I think, yeah, we have everything to be hopeful about. We need to be hopeful about our future, and we need to work hard to be able to like transform this hope in kind of reality, from a dream to reality.
Fadji, you are such an inspiration to me, and I'm sure to so many of our listeners. We are so honored to have had you on the podcast today. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed it. Thank you so much.
We hope you enjoyed this episode of the Teens in AI podcast. Thank you so much again to Dr. Maina for speaking with us. We'd love to hear your thoughts on the podcast, so do get in touch with us via social media. You can follow us on Instagram and Twitter at Teens in AI Pod. Tune in every Thursday for a new episode where we will be speaking to more leading figures in the world of AI. Until then, thanks for listening, and I hope you have a great day.